Hello, I'm Marilyn Priel with The Better Part. Today we're going to learn about new dental techniques of special interest to seniors. Stay tuned.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program was inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
The children of today are very fortunate. With fluoride in the water, fluoride in their toothpaste, and sealants applied to their teeth, they'll have very few cavities. However, we are fortunate as well because there are many new dental techniques available now, so we're not going to be toothless like our parents were. Our guest today is a very prominent and popular dentist in the Bay Area. He's did his studies at the University of Southern California and has practiced in the city of Fremont for the past 16 years. Meet Dr. Brad Paini. Hi, Brad.
Hi, Marilyn.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Dr. Paini, we adults drink the water with the fluoride in it, and we brush our teeth with fluoride toothpaste. Why do we continue getting cavities?
Yeah. As an adult, you got to remember that the toothpaste and the fluoride in the water, that's great when you're developing and the teeth are forming and the fluoride will get incorporated into the tooth. But as you and I mature and we drink the water, our teeth are already fully formed. And so the only benefit we get from the fluoride and the toothpaste and the water is a little topical coating just on the tooth. And I mean, they measure it in angstroms, which is the wavelength of light. So typically, it only gets in maybe one or two atoms into the top surface of the tooth. So the first time you take your teeth and you grind them, that little layer of fluoride is gone. So the fluoride for me and you is not going to do a lot. So consequently, we still get cavities. But there's other things too. As you become an adult, other pressures cause you to do things. One, as an adult, a lot of people have a cough or a little tickle in their throat. And so they constantly suck on mints or lozenges, and these lozenges have sugar in them. Same thing with these people that are in business and they want to go out and present things and they want to keep their breath smelling good, so they use breath mints. These breath mints, almost all of them contain a small amount of sugar. And these sugars just sit there and they dissolve into the cheek there and it penetrates into the roots, and so we get a lot of root line cavities on the adults that are either sucking on hard candies, lozenges, or these breath mints. Mm-hmm. And so there's still other sources that are going to penetrate the tooth. Even though we're using the fluorides in the water and the toothpaste, as you say, we still get these other outside sources. Now, one of the other things, too, that we haven't touched on is systemic diseases. Typically, as you get older, a lot of people get diabetes. The diabetic patient has a higher blood sugar level. The saliva in the mouth is a weak mirror of the blood. And so as the blood sugar goes up, so does the saliva, the sugar in the saliva. And so constantly bathing the teeth in a saliva that has sugar in it will cause root line cavities as well. So you see, you have diabetes, you have these breath lozenges. Other sources, you'll still get cavities as an adult.
Okay. What about the sealants? What are these sealants that they put on the teeth now?
The sealants are something that came about probably in the last 15 to 20 years, and it's a plastic coating that's put just on the back molars of your teeth. And it forms down into the grooves, hardens into the grooves of the tooth, and prevents any food from packing in there and then consequently decaying. Unfortunately, most of our teeth are already filled with silver, and so you can't apply them to a tooth that's already been filled. But on the youth of today, as soon as their teeth erupt through the gums, we paint them with this plastic, and it's a nice barrier. It's just one more thing to help prevent decay.
I see. So for us, then, it's not feasible to do that. It's only for children.
Only if you don't have a cavity in the tooth. If it's a virgin tooth, then you can seal it. Otherwise,
find one of those.
Not many on most of our generation.
Okay. Now, how long should a filling last? Or, you know, just...
Well, if you go to the insurance companies, they'll tell you they'll pay for it every year. If you took a filling and we changed it on you every year of your life, They would pay for it routinely. But realistically, a filling should last you anywhere from 15 to 30 years. And you'll see that on a lot of patients where 30 years out and they've got a filling that was done usually by some other dentist, not me, many, many years ago, and it's still there, and we're just now getting around to changing it to some of the newer materials.
I have some questions about crowns. First of all, how long does a crown, will it last forever, or do those have to be replaced?
Yeah, nothing lasts forever in this world. Again, if you go back to the insurance companies, which have kind of set the standards as far as what they feel is a normal lifespan of different products, they'll tell you that they'll replace a crown for you every 5 years. They will pay for it every 5 years to be replaced. But again, realistically, as a dentist, you can't expect your work to come back every 5 years and be replaced. That's all you would be doing in your practice is replacing your crowns. Typical lifespan of a crown, we usually tell the patient, again, it's up to them. It depends on how they take care of it. If they decide not to brush it, it may last a year and it'll be out of their mouth. The whole tooth will be out. But typically, they'll go anywhere from 5 years to the life of the patient.
You have to brush crowns. Why? I mean, of course, you know, for sanitary reasons, but
it's kind of odd.
Why do you have to brush your
crowns? Crowns are man-made. Obviously, they're made out of porcelain or gold. And you say, well, what's going to decay? You're right, they will not decay. But obviously, around where they seat onto the tooth, there's a margin there. And the margin has a little cement barrier there. The root is underneath it. You've got to maintain that. Obviously, if you're not going to brush, you're going to be prone to decay or gum disease, which then you could lose the tooth or re-decay underneath the crown.
To seep into the root, then around the gum.
Seep into the root or around mm-hmm. the tooth. Yeah, you've got to still maintain these things.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes I see crowns, it's so obvious. And then other times they're just barely detectable. Does that have to do with gum problems or the application?
Well, you know, it used to be the hardest thing in dentistry was to change one front tooth into a crown. Some kid would fall down, break his front tooth, and then you had a dilemma. You had everything else was natural, but you had to put one fake tooth in the front of his mouth. And of course, crowns, we want strength, so we have a metal backing underneath them. And I'll try and show you this here in a second. You have a metal backing underneath them, and then you stack the porcelain on top of it to make it look somewhat tooth-like. Well, you've always got this metal barrier underneath it that you're fighting.
A little black thing.
And that's why a lot of times people smile and you say, geez, they've got this nice gray line right up by the gum line. Mm-hmm. That's got to be a fake tooth. And sure enough, it is. Well, nowadays, though, they've reinvented the whole crown system where they've got glasses that are so strong, you don't need the metal backing underneath them. And they put fiber reinforcements in there, kind of like a fiberglass material, again, to strengthen these things and to keep them metal free. And so now you can put a crown on the tooth without any of the gunmetal gray showing through underneath there, without the gray margin. And the beauty is that you don't have any of the metal showing through, and you get the light to penetrate all the way through the different layers of the tooth and get this natural depth
and
opalescence to the tooth.
Uh-huh.
Oh, it's just beautiful now. But we didn't have these things 15 years ago, or even 20 years ago, or even 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. This has only been probably in the last 5 years we've been able to get these things in.
Can somebody break a crown off? I mean, it's like a tooth. If you bite something, can the crown come off? Or is it cemented so securely into the stand that...
Obviously, you know, people can break their own teeth, and you figure God was a pretty good artist on that. So obviously anything we craft is very fallible. So yeah, we see crowns break. We see the porcelain break. Mm-hmm. You do have to be a little bit more careful when you have fake objects in your mouth, mm-hmm. fake teeth, prosthetics, and things mm-hmm. like that. They're all breakable. Yeah.
With crowns available, do people ever get bridges anymore?
Yeah, there's still a need for bridges in that if you lose a tooth, you have a space there, somehow you've got to connect the span, just like a bridge that goes across water. You have a piling on either side and you connect the two. And that's the same idea with a bridge. I'll show you some examples here. This is a bridge, and again, we're missing a tooth in the center, and these usually don't come off. You can't usually take them off with your finger. These are cemented permanently, and they span the gap. And of course, this is a porcelain bridge. They also make gold bridges, which you can see on this model right here. This is a gold bridge, and again, the patient is missing a tooth. So yes, you have crowns to replace individual teeth that have broken down, but if you've completely lost a tooth, there's still a need for a bridge. Now, there's other ways nowadays, of course, to replace a missing tooth. We have the advent of implants, and there's also the old standby, which is a partial, which is something that does come in and out and it clips in the mouth.
But I had a question about this bridge, because I'm seeing three. Now, that looks like three crowns to me, but it's actually one piece.
It's all fabricated as one piece. And again, even nowadays, they're able to make these things metal-free. Even though these all show metal, this is a platinum. The white is obviously a platinum. This is a gold substructure for the strength. Again, they're now able to do this with carbon-reinforced graphites and make these things one span metal-free, which adds to the beauty and the luster of these things. And you can almost be undetectable with a bridge in your mouth.
How do you attach it now?
They're glued onto the tooth.
Onto the tooth.
Onto the existing tooth.
Oh, I'm confused now, because you said if a tooth is missing, how do they?
Well, you use the teeth on either side to help support it, and you do have to prepare them. So you have a missing tooth, and then you need a tooth on either side to make a bridge. Mm-hmm. And as long as there's a good, healthy tooth on either side, you can prepare it or drill it down. You have to reduce it on all sides to allow a shell of the metal to cover it, or fiberglass or glass. And then you make your span out of it. I'll take this one off. This one's not glued in, but you'll see that's one solid piece. And these are the teeth on either side that have been prepared. Can you see that?
So it takes three teeth, three spaces to fill in one missing tooth.
Something like that.
Okay, or something on that. And this would be called a permanent...
Permanent bridge, because again, you normally can't hold them in your hand and show them to the patient this,
or
the patient
can't.
They're
glued on. Okay.
Yes. And these function just like teeth. You can generate just as much crushing force with a bridge as your natural teeth.
Okay.
Most people function with these, chew down, crush, and have no comments at all. They feel it functions just as naturally as their own teeth.
And they don't look bad, do they? Because you can't tell the difference.
Yeah, the gold ones you can definitely tell, but the newer ones, they blend in just with the smile, and you don't even know a patient's got a false tooth there.
Okay, now. I hear about a partial plate or a removable bridge. How does that work?
The seniors, again, are going to have their choice. They're going to have, if they're missing a tooth anywhere in the mouth, they have a choice of a bridge. Again, if you have two teeth on either side, you can form a bridge there. You can replace it with a partial, which is usually relegated to when you have more than one missing tooth, where you're missing many, many teeth, and economics and other things come into play, and you say, how can I replace the most teeth for the least amount of money? You'll go into something that's removable. You can take it out, you can scrub it, and then put it back in your mouth. And I've got some examples of those as well. These are what we call partials. And again, they do come out of your mouth, and this is always the way they function. And you can see these things clip in and clip out of the teeth. And you can see on this particular model here, the patient is missing all their back teeth. And so this would simply clip in. And you can see we've added five teeth onto this patient. And these things typically run approximately $1,000. But if you had to bridge this, a typical bridge, every one of those bridges that I showed you as an example, runs close to $3,000.
To make it permanent.
And that's just to replace one missing tooth. Here we've replaced five for $1,000. So obviously economics comes into play. Function-wise, all these are not as comfortable. Patients many times will just simply leave these on their nightstand.
Lose them.
You generate 1/7 the crushing force with a partial, typically, that you would with natural teeth. So you can't chew everything that you would like to with these things. They load up food underneath the saddles. They're fraught with a lot of discomfort, but many people adapt, and they do just fine with these things. So.
If they remove them at night and don't sleep in them, then don't their teeth shift, and then they want to put it back in, and maybe it hurts?
Uncomfortable? That won't happen overnight, but it does happen if they leave it out for several months, or they end up in a hospital stay for an extended period, and then they go back and try and put them in. They're very tight, or they won't fit at all. Yeah.
And then you were telling me earlier, too, that it's a hazard sometimes to have the partials, that they don't like to make them if they can prevent doing so.
One of the hardest things with partials is the comfort level. Again, you can see it's a big device to put in your mouth and wear for the rest of your life. And so what a lot of dentists will do is try and make these things very, very small. If they just want to add two teeth, they'll take all this part off and just put two little clips on either side, and we call that a spider partial.
Doesn't have the gum. The plastic.
It still has the gum, but just it doesn't have all this other part of it.
Okay.
Just one little segment that just replaces. The problem, though, is, of course, it's a little more comfortable, But if you ever get hit on the back or you fall or something happens to you, they're very easily dislodged and they can go right down the throat. And of course, you can aspirate them into the lung, which makes it very difficult to get it back. So much harder to try and swallow or aspirate a device like this rather than the smaller one. So size does play a part in safety here, but it's not the most comfortable thing.
And then, of course, as seniors, they do cough a lot and choke easily, so pretty dangerous to have a little small device. You mentioned implants, and I find that fascinating. I think it's wonderful, and I'd like to know more how that works.
Implants are the cutting edge of dentistry, and again, when I got out of school 16 years ago, if you had asked me, how can I replace, I have no teeth in the back, and yet I want some kind of function back there, can I put an implant in there? We would have told you flat out that if we put an implant in, the only thing you would be eating is Jell-O or mashed potatoes, and within a couple of years you would have to take the implant out. They were not functional, and the reason for that is that when we put the implant in, we would drill it with a high-speed drill, which would then burn the bone right away. So it formed a socket that wasn't conducive to taking the implant. And then we would build on the implant right away. And as soon as you load the implant and you start to function with it, you've got a burned bone socket with a metal screw in there. Mm. And the things would fail. They would fail every time. The whole industry has been revolutionized now. And so now you look at the success or the function of these things, and people use these things just like their own teeth. They're strong. They last a tremendous amount of time. There's no reason not to go with an implant if you have the finances to afford it. Now, they are expensive, and no insurance company will pay for them. But these things are tremendous anchors in the jaw that can be built on, that can be used for a wide variety of purposes.
Do you have anything you can show us how an implant is installed? Okay, it looks fairly complicated, actually.
Yeah, this is a diagram of what an implant looks like going into the bone. This is a titanium screw, and again, it's placed into the bone, and then this is covered up with tissue and left there for 6 months so that the bone can integrate into the screw and actually lock in around it. And then at the end of that six-month period, the oral surgeon will expose, and the dentist will go ahead and put the top part in, which is like a post or a screw that comes up, and then you have a variety of things that you can then attach to the implant. So it's not a quick process. It does require the body to integrate the bone around an implant.
It takes an oral surgeon and a dentist then to do this.
Typically, again, like anything in life, you want to have somebody do this that does it all the time. Most dentists do not do that many implants to be familiar with where the structures are. When you place an implant in, you've got to remember there's sinuses up on the top, there's nerves that run down on the bottom. You don't want to hit any of these structures without catastrophic events happening afterwards. So you have to avoid these. So the oral surgeons are usually the best ones to place the implant, and the dentist is usually the best one to build on it.
What kind of material do they use for that actual implant that goes down into the bone?
It's all titanium. The body loves titanium for some reason, and I've got some other examples here of the implants. These are other implants that we've done on the models here, and you can see this patient here has had four placed up in the front. He had no lower teeth, and again, perfect situation, had a lower denture that was just flopping around. And maybe a lot of your seniors can relate to this, is that they have an uncomfortable lower, they can't get any pressure out of it, can't chew, have almost no bony ridge for the denture to set on. So we've put four titanium screws down in this man's jaw here, and then built a substructure, and then set his denture on top of that, and it actually clicks in, locks in, and I'll tell you just personally, this man came back to us just recently, and it's been this case has been out about a year and a half now, where he had fractured his lower denture in half because he was biting so hard onto some carrots, some raw carrots. You can generate a tremendous amount of force on these things to where you will break your acrylic denture. Mm-hmm. But even the two halves, he was able to just snap them back in place and wore it that way for six more months before he ever came back to me to repair it. These things are incredibly resilient, and the denture plate's usually the weakest part of the link. But you can see this man was eating raw carrots with a lower plate, which is almost unheard of with somebody with a denture. This is one, also just a single that we put in. The patient had lost a tooth from gum disease. And wanted to restore some function to the back of her mouth where she'd lost her molar. So we put a single implant in there, let it integrate into the bone for the 6 months, then put our post up through there and built her actually a nice bridge back in this area.
There's something that troubles me about when I go to the dentist, and that's sterilization and cleanliness. I worry about catching something. I did have a cousin who got hepatitis at the dentist's office. And I get very nervous when a dentist walks into my treatment area and he has gloves already on his hand when he walks in. Is that something that I have complained about that in a nice way? Is that something that I should worry about? Or
It's valid. Again, going back to my own training, in our dental school, we never wore gloves. We never wore gloves except if we were doing oral surgery and we were taking out some teeth. And then we would put them on just for the surgery and then take them off. And of course, nowadays with the crisis of AIDS coming about, hepatitis, the new strains of hepatitis, we've had to update. We've had to modernize. And it's all been good for dentistry. So many of the practices beforehand where we weren't using the gloves and we're going from patient to patient, you could spread diseases. And so these are things that have absolutely revolutionized dentistry now. And you'll see it's added tremendously to the cost and to the time consumption of doing a procedure in dentistry. And I'd be happy to take you back and I'll show you the office a little bit and how we've had to redesign the entire office to accommodate OSHA standards, not only to protect ourselves from the patients, but also to protect the patients from any diseases that we may transmit to them.
Let's go do that.
Okay. Well, what you'll find here, Marilyn, is that this is a modern sterilization room. You have a dirty side and a clean side, and of course OSHA requires you to go through a rigorous process in sterilizing your tools and your instruments prior to using them on another patient again. So when the girls will finish up a procedure, they'll bring in the dirty trays into this room here. They'll throw anything disposable into the trash chute here. And then anything sharp, and this can include needles or scalpel blades, go into a special container over here that is also a biohazard that then has to be disposed of properly. And of course that involves fees and a transport service that have to specially dispose of or incinerate those sharp containers. After the tools are brought in here then, the things that are not disposable go into the next stage, which is an ultrasonic sterilizer, which is this little device right here. The metal tools are brought in, put in a little basket like this, and of course then we turn this on. And with sonic energy, that will go ahead and take off the outer layer of debris off the tools. And we leave that in there for typically a 15-minute cycle. Then the tools are taken out of the basket, rinsed off in the sink, scrubbed with a hand scrub, and then we're brought over to the core of the sterilization system, which is the autoclave. And this is one of the newer autoclaves. And what this is where you put the metal instruments in a container, and this happens to be using steam and heat, and of course it heat sterilizes the tools. It runs through about a 6-minute cycle. The instruments are placed in here. You select a cycle and start, and these things come out completely sterile. Now once the sterile instruments are completed, we then do our tray setups, which right here you'll see all the trays are then packed with the instruments, with any of the gauzes or the plastics that we're going to need, and then they're stacked up here into the cabinets, and these are all color-coded for different procedures that we'll be doing throughout the day. Now what I'll do is I'll go ahead and I'll take you into the rooms and I'll show you what procedures have to be done now to disinfect the rooms as well after a patient completes a procedure. And again, Marilyn, when you come into the operatories, this is where the patient's going to be worked on, of course. And in most offices nowadays, you have to have several operatories because this is a process. Once you get done with a patient, there's a whole breakdown process that's involved in sterilizing the room, or actually not sterilizing, but disinfecting a room before you can seat another patient in the room. You can see in this particular room, we have barriers. So anything that the doctor may touch with his hands has a special barrier so we don't then cross-contaminate and leave debris or blood products or saliva on, for example, the light.
So that's replaced then after each patient, the little plastic covers?
All these are disposed of immediately after the patient's left, as well as the headrest. You'll see over here on even where we use our tray, you'll see these are all disposable. These are then taken off and thrown away. These are saliva ejectors. These disconnect the air-water spigots that squirt the water into the patient's mouth. These disconnect, and these are all then either autoclaved or disposed of. Now, you'll also notice that in every room, you're going to have a box of masks that the doctor will wear, and also the gloves that he should be putting on in the room as he goes to work on the patient. And you should never see a doctor go from room to room with the same set of gloves on. Every room should have their own gloves. And he should never be traveling throughout the office with a patient's spit or blood on his hands. Now, after the patient leaves, obviously, we tear down all these plastic barriers. We also have to disinfect. And that's done with a glutaraldehyde spray, which is kept, again, in every operatory. And this will they'll spray down the chairs, they'll spray down the counters, they'll spray down all the other surfaces that cannot be taken out of here and put through an autoclave. They'll wipe them down, and it's called a spray wipe spray. So they'll spray, wipe down the area, and then spray it again and let this solution just saturate the area and basically evaporate, which takes about a 10-minute period of time. So you can see you need multiple rooms. You can't just put a patient in right after the other. You have to wait and cycle your patients this way.
Well, thank you so much. I feel so much better from what I've learned today, and especially all this cleanliness thing. I'm worried about that a lot. So.
Yeah, it's reassuring to actually sit down and see what a dentist has to do nowadays, or a staff has to do, mm-hmm. in order to treat a patient. It's much more difficult nowadays and much more costly, obviously, to treat somebody nowadays than it did even 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for giving us all this information and coming on the show.
All right, you're welcome. Thank you very much.
We hope you've learned a lot today. If you have any ideas for future programs you'd like to see, or if you would like to work on our crew, please contact the Cupertino Senior Center. Thanks for being with us. Goodbye.